You are now listening to Vigilantes Radio, presented by the Only One Media Group. This is the people's choice for quality art, interviews, music and hot topics. Hosted by Dini Mussolini and co-hosted by Banditti. Call in to join the mix at 701-801-9813. All episodes of this podcast are available for free download at least 1 hour after each show at www.onlyonemediagroup.com. We welcome all. Enjoy the show.
Yo, there are 27,000 of you guys online with us tonight, and it feels so good to be back with you guys once again. So one time for my people who are indigos, starseeds, light workers, and vegans. I'm a vegan myself. We are averaging, ladies and gentlemen, to over 34,000 plus listeners and over 888,000 downloads worldwide. We've been at this for 3 solid years. I appreciate all you guys who have been rocking with the kid on this journey, and we're still growing, baby. It is all because of you guys, most definitely. We are the people who have dedicated their lives to music, art, movies, and research in every aspect, and we want to allow you that opportunity to tell your story. Man, we've had celebrities on the show, from Grammy Award-winning artists to nominees to actors, comedians, technology geniuses, visual artists, from authors to professors and aliens, or people who think they're aliens. It doesn't matter, though, who you are or what walk of life that you come from. Come on our show and talk to us. So check it out. To book an interview or just share a real cool story, email me at vradio@onlyonemediagroup.com. I am passionate about what I do, just as passionate about what you do, and together, yes, together, we can get your voice heard by the people who should hear it. So let's create something incredible. And with that, hello out there, and welcome to another episode of our podcast, Vigilantes Radio. Thank you again, as always, for tuning in and being a part of our audience family. If you like information on how to call in, ask questions, or speak to our guests, dial 701-801-9813, or hop in the mix directly from my website, which is onlyonemediagroup.com. Scroll over to the Vigilantes Radio tab and slap that go live button, and you'll be right here in the chat room and in the mix with all of us. Feel free to shoot over some questions while we are commentating, and while our guests are still here, of course. And as always, all episodes are available for free download, and you can grab that from our server over at Spreaker.com/Only One Media Group, iTunes, YouTube. There's an app called Podcast Addict. That's right. Carry us around 24/7, 365 days in your pocket, purse, wallet, backpack, or whatever. And we are right there for stream or download. Also, feel free to bootleg. Sharing is caring. And of course, you can grab it from our website. And that, again, is onlyonemediagroup.com. Like I said, that goes for every single episode that we've ever aired. All right, well, tonight's episode is the Angelique-Bates interview, and I am your host, Dini Mussolini. Like I said, man, there's about 27,000 of you guys on the line with us tonight. Oh my goodness, you guys are going to break the internet, man. Yeah, my bill is going to be so high, but that's all good because we have an icon here with us tonight, right? Yes. So I just want to tell you guys before we kick that off, you know, the real reason why you guys are here with Dini is for Angelique, but I'm not jealous. Of course not. No, no. Anyways, so find the good in what happens. What feels like a setback does not always have to be a setback. It can be an opportunity to find a better way. It's easy to be thankful for all the things that go your way, yet there is even more power in being thankful when things don't go your way. You can find the good in what happens, whatever may happen. You can find a positive way forward from even the most difficult situations. Everything is an opportunity when you decide to make it an opportunity. Just saying that doesn't make it so. Your actions and your attitude can make it so. Listen, guys, Even from the lowest point in the dark valley, there's a path leading to the sunlit mountain peak. No matter where you are or what has happened, your next step can be a positive one. So, feel your faith, feel your courage, feel your strength and resilience, and take that positive step. You have much goodness to give and to live. Better believe it. All right, guys, so like I said, tonight is the Angelique Bates interview. Of course, man, my Facebook and Twitter were just, you know, blowing up about, hey, I want to ask you this, I want to ask you that. Hey, you'll get your chance, especially if we have the time, of course. So there's no need to worry about that. I got you covered, baby. Don't worry. So, yeah, let's go ahead and get it kicked off, right? So let's do it.
Fresh out the box. Stop. Look and watch. Ready yet? Get set. It's all that.
You guys know I couldn't resist that, yeah. And we are the people who have dedicated their weekdays and nights to music, books, movies, literature, news, business ventures, and conspiracies. It's just talking every aspect from our incredible writing and promotion here on our new Facebook page that you can find over at Vigilantes Radio to our interviews and music shows on this podcast, or our spiritual and intuitive talk on Skeptics, or our brand new show called Hated It, where Mike and I review movies of all kinds and do voiceover comedy. We spend each and every day giving our maximum effort to create a vibrant, exciting, indie, and professional community for all creative minds that coexist in this beautiful artistic world. Our special guest tonight, as you already know, is the icon, actress, comedian, and yes, we are giving up her identity as Superwoman. Hate me later. Yes, we are talking about the one and only Angelique Bates. She's a seasoned impersonator and a lyrical arsonist, which we may find out later on. So with that, hello, Angelique. You're alive in the mix with all of us. How is it going and how are you feeling?
Hey, I'm blessed, never stressed.
definitely.
Thanks for having me on the show.
Oh, you're welcome. So how is sunny California?
Not so sunny right now. You know, it actually looked like it was trying to rain a little bit earlier, so we had to kind of hurry up and rush back in. You know, the weather's been kind of bipolar nowadays.
Yeah, I just left San Diego a few months ago, and it was kind of like that. Like, it was, you know, sunny one day, cloudy the next. And I was like, what is going on
right
in Cali?
Hot, blowing cold air at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, those darn scientists messing with the ozone again.
Hey, but you know, that's too much truth. They don't believe in that.
Yeah, I'll start getting hate mail in a bit.
We know.
Yep. All right, so I've talked a ton about, you know, things that people can do in the moment, how they can seize the moment, that kind of thing, on our other show called Skeptics. And it deals in a lot about, you know, commit, spirituality, crystals, aliens, amongst other things that people don't like to talk about. But that moment where time just stops and it becomes your time, like go time, nut up or shut up, as they would say. We all heard the stories about your all that auditions, dressing up as Urkel. We know that you were auditioning for two roles at a time. One was for a lead in a movie about a street character, a young girl, who had lost everything. And the second one was for all that. But if they didn't know, now they know. Well, we want to fast forward just a bit to that moment when you first attempted stand-up comedy. Yeah, that moment. That debut moment that will either make you or break you. You know, where you sweating just buckets of sweat. So tell us about that experience, where it happened, when it happened, and your feelings about it all.
Wow. When I did a stand-up comedy, my mom, she put me in the Laugh Factory boot camp, which was hosted by Keenan Wayans. No, it was Damon Wayans. Same family, but it was Damon Wayans.
Yeah.
And Jay Moore was another one of the comedians. Dave Chappelle came through. I believe I was the only black female in that camp. And one of the youngest ones.
Wow.
I was probably 14. And I ended up graduating. And my very first performance was on the Laugh Factory stage. And it was my first paid gig. And I was the first African-American female in the camp to graduate. So it was pretty dope.
Wow.
I was nervous as a bug.
Oh, yeah.
But, I had never really performed to an audience of that magnitude where they're just staring at you. You know, I was always doing theater and I was doing competitions, but there's a trick where we don't really have to look at you. We can, you know, we can look above because everyone's like, you know, sitting in their seats and we can look at the lights. It looks like we're looking at you, but we can kind of look past without getting nervous. Not so much when you're doing stand-up. You know, you have everybody at the top, on the side, in front, right underneath you. So, you know, it was definitely a frightening experience, but it was also amazing because back then that's when Entertainment Tonight was still around. And, they actually interviewed me, which was pretty dope because I think that was my second time being interviewed by them because when I got All That, they came out there and interviewed me for that. So to have them come back and interview me for Laugh Factory and actually, like I said, to be coached by legends. Like, how many people can say they were coached by Dave Chappelle or, you know, Damon Wayans, Jay Moore? Like, we had so many legends. And through the Laugh Factory, I got to meet Richard Pryor. And the night that I met him, I was so upset because my phone died seconds before I could get a picture with him.
Oh,
yeah. Wow. It's fun, but, you know, I still have that memory, but I'm like, oh, man, yep, I got to meet Richard Pryor at the Laugh Factory. It was the most awesomest thing. He got to see me perform and everything. It was just like, that stuff like that, you know, those are timeless memories that you'll always have, you know? So, yeah, I definitely stand-up has its moments. I say it's probably a lot easier, though, when you're a kid because there's a lot of things you don't have to deal with when you become an adult. But, you know, when you're a kid, your material is a lot different from when you become an adult because you can't do kid jokes anymore once you hit that age change.
Mm-hmm.
But being a kid, you just don't have to deal with a lot of the effery that's in the industry.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that is if your parent is blocking it. not everybody is so lucky.
Definitely. So you graduated from the Laugh Factory. What did you do with that after the graduation? Like, did you go on tour? Or?
I didn't go on tour because I was still a minor. I feel like I was still doing Nickelodeon, to be quite honest. Because, you know, they gave us a plaque and everything, and I was actually still doing appearances. I was hitting up the L.A. circuit. And I did that for a while. I did a couple of appearances, but everything was like in California. I didn't really venture out, you know, because my material was clean. It was family, you know, material, but it was a lot of vets and other people that were in that circuit kept on talking about, oh, you know, she needs to, she can't really do family comedy. It was unheard of back then. Nowadays, it's cool. You know, you got Christian comedy, you got clean comedy, you got family comedy, but back then it was all raunchy. So, you know, you have this kid that's, you know, going up into the Ha Ha Cafe with all these other vets. You got Scrunchy, you know, you got everybody else. And it's crazy. It's just like, here comes this little kid that's the only minor. And everybody else is talking about booty and all kinds of other stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm singing Aretha Franklin and talking about freaking rainbows and stuff, you know? It was definitely different. I mean, it was funny, you know, but it was just to get people to even book me because it was like, oh, she's just doing clean. And, you know, when you're dealing with adults that are drinking, you know, they want to hear what they want to hear.
Oh, yeah. I can imagine. Right. Yep. All right, so you're involved in two seasons of one of the most important parts of people's childhood and teenage years, the infamous All of That. I couldn't resist playing the theme song, of course. TLC, they definitely rocked.
Right. Much respect.
Yes. So fans all over are attempting to jump in the air slow-mo style, but it just doesn't quite work that way. I even tried it just now when the, you know, it was playing. I tried to find a trampoline so I can jump, and you know, it
hilarious.
Didn't work. Yeah, I almost broke an ankle, but
oh, yeah, can't bury yourself.
Yeah. So I've heard that most people
really
refer.
Huh?
Huh? Say that again.
I said you really can't be hurting yourself down with what they just did with the insurance. You gotta be real careful.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I got to walk around in a bubble. Like, man, insurance policies are crazy.
Oh, yeah, especially since they just
crazy.
Got rid of Obamacare. So, you know, mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll be real careful.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But, yeah.
So, like, you know, most people I've heard refer to the show as, like, pre-Saturday Night Live. I didn't always think so. I always thought it was a cleaner version of the show in living color. And that's because of the quality and the skills that you guys displayed and, you know, the material that the writers wrote. So you were the first cast member introduced in the opening theme by the song, you know, TLC. Okay,
right.
So I'm still kind of googly-eyed, though, how beautiful you have remained. Like, a lot of people don't really age well, but you have aged very well. Is it the Haitian and African root?
Yeah, it's probably that Haitian and Indian or whatever, and that coconut oil.
Yeah, a lot of coconut. See, I'm Jamaican. I'm part Jamaican and part Italian. So, yeah, that coconut oil, that's something else.
Right, you already know about that.
Mm-hmm.
And definitely having to try to, you know, keep your eating have it clean. Like, people don't even realize how important that is, what you're putting into your body.
Definitely.
You know, so I was real lucky that it didn't catch up with me.
Definitely. Yeah. All right, so my real question is, after all that rambling, is how was the transition from a show like that, you know, to work on the shows like Strong Medicine and Boston Public that you did in the early 2000s?
The transition, I mean, as far as, you know, going from a different show, it was cool, you know. I loved it, especially Strong Medicine. That was pretty awesome. I actually had ended up doing a guest appearance on Unsolved Mysteries, too. And then I did Boston Public, and I had did a movie called Sweet Potato Ride. You know, I love acting, you know, I love entertaining, I love making people laugh and, you know, helping people forget whatever problems they may be dealing with at that moment. I didn't get to work as much as I wanted to because there were issues from when I was on the show that traveled over and, you know, I pretty much got blackballed by the network for something that was out of my control.
Mm-hmm.
So, for like years, actually not even just for years, like even to this day, you know, I'm still dealing with the ricochet of that, you know what I'm saying? So that's why, you know, everybody, you know, where has she been? You know, how come you're not acting? How come you're not doing this? It's been a struggle. It's really been a struggle because I got blocked. And, you know, that's why a lot of people don't get to see me as much as they would love to. I mean, it's kind of, you know, it's to a point where they can't control it anymore. But that's why it seems like I haven't been around for so many years.
Right. And I know all about that block thing. I work for Busy Bone.
Right.
Personal and business. And he was blocked for a very, very long time that we had to work through a lot of, you know, things just to get it work. So it's very frustrating. I don't think people really realize that that is an actual thing that can happen to you.
Oh, it's real. It's real. And
it is very real.
If you're a minority, oh, it's even worse. You know what I'm saying? So it's like you're a minority and you're a female. It's worse. And even when you said, like, you know, at an age, that was a whole nother thing too. Like, I've always looked like a kid for the most part. So even when I had hit 18 and 21, people still thought I was 15 and 16.
Wow.
So, you know, like I said, like, that block has been real. And it's crazy because I don't know if you ever remember this game. Well, if you did theater or if you ever had any drama classes, it's a game called Telephone. And, you know, you start off, you tell one person a story, and it's supposed to go around in a circle. And by the time it gets back to the person who told the story first, you have to see if the story has came back the same way or did it get manipulated by the time it got back to them. That's pretty much what the industry is. And there's people that weren't there when everything was happening, and there's people that were there covering it, but you have people that they just, everybody has to be in somebody's business, so they just have to act like they were there, and then they put a spin on it. So it's like this vicious cycle. Nobody knows what they're talking about. Everybody thinks they know what's going on. Some of them weren't even born, feel me? But, you know, everybody knows something, you know, because they just have to be in, you know, center of attention. Well, I know somebody. I know that person. I was there. No, you weren't. But, you know, not even with me, I've seen it happen to other people. Like, everybody has a life. People, like, we have real life issues. We have families we got to take care of. And it's just like that one vicious lie can just keep on going and going and going and destroy people's lives.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Nobody cares. You know? So, you know.
You're right.
A few of us are still survivors and still fighters, but the process is hell. Let me tell you.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Man. And I'm glad you stuck in there, because most people just take their ball and go home and, you know, find a desk job somewhere in a nice cubicle. But it seems like you kept at it, busy, kept at it, and, you know, here we are.
Yeah, I mean, I did. I mean, it was to a point, like I said, I wasn't working at all. Like, I couldn't get a job if my life depended on it. So I had to start hitting 9 to 5. But it was frustrating because everybody was coming in recognizing me. I had little kids. Like, this was the crazy part. When I was on the show, we didn't have cable. I didn't move out the hood. I was still in the hood. So I didn't really realize how big and how much of an international sensation that all that was. I didn't know
it
was the number one children's show. It was crazy. I didn't find out until, like, after. Because, you know, when I got released months before they were supposed to start filming the Good Burger movie. I was supposed to be in the Good Burger movie. I was supposed to be back. But when everything went down, obviously I wasn't in. Around that time period is when I started noticing, because a lot of people didn't know that I wasn't coming back third season. I was supposed to come back third season, but I didn't. So I had people just, like, recognizing me off the street. It was crazy. I was at one job. And I remember this little Asian kid, I will never forget it. This little Asian kid came in and said my full name and was like, oh, are you angelique-bates? And I looked at him like, who are you? And I was like, yeah. Like, I don't know what's going on, but I'm at work. And he's like, he smiled and disappeared. I kid you not, like 7 minutes later, I see almost 30 kids and the teacher standing outside our store window, and the teacher comes in and is like, the kids want to have an autograph and a picture. And I remember my manager came out, because I'm not going to put it on the application. Oh, yeah, I was on Nickelodeon. Like, who does that?
Right.
And he's like, what's going on? And he was, like, super geek. And they were like, yeah, you know, we're not trying to cause any problems. You know, we just want a picture. He was like, oh, yeah, just go. Like, it was so funny. Like, from that day on, he was just like, you need any time off? You want an extra break? Like, he became a fan. Like, he's a fan of the show and didn't even realize it was me. Like, it was just insane. And so even with the time period that I wasn't working, you know, when people, that's why I always tell people, I'm like, give people their flowers when they're here. You know, so it wasn't like I was really, anybody was giving me flowers. So, you know, I pretty much figured I was forgotten. And especially with the drama that was going on, it was what it was. But when social media started cracking and I started getting inbox messages from fans and fans that were going through real life issues, I had emails from people that wanted to commit suicide, that were having drug addictions, that were, had disorders, and they were actually reaching out to me. Some of them didn't even reach out to their own family. And they just wanted someone to listen to them and telling me that I changed their life. And just the fact that I was even talking to them changed their So it was just, it started being a wake-up call. But then when the 90s was back, completely resurrected everything, that came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
It was like, whoa. Like, it was like, it was real in the streets.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It got crazy.
Yeah. So going back to, receiving messages from fans, and I know that's not in the notes, but did that start, was that like the start of you being like an advocate for bullying and domestic violence and those kind of issues?
It was a mixture. It was really a mixture because if I could tell you the kind of messages I get in my inbox, it varies. Some inspirational and some just like flat out crazy.
Yeah.
It took a minute. I think it was because I've dealt with a lot because I am a survivor of domestic violence. Mm-hmm. I am a rape survivor. I had issues, child, whatever. So a lot of that was just like having to heal. And it took some years, and even what was going on with the industry, just I got tired of taking the hits. So I think when I had my kids, that's what kind of like made me see it in a whole different retrospect, because it was like, now okay, it's cool y'all messing with me, y'all want to throw punches at me, but now I got kids and my kids.
Oh,
are getting
yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So it's a whole other aspect. It's like, talk about me all you want to, but now you're blocking me from being able to take care of my kids. That's where I have an issue. If you're going to release me, but don't blackball me over something I didn't do. Like, let me go ahead and make my living and take care of my kids. Now you interfering with me, keeping a roof over our head and keeping clothes on their back. That's where I have an issue. And I think that's with any parent. When it comes to their kids, we become mama bears, papa bears, all that. It's a whole nother ball game. So when I had my kids, my whole mind frame just, turned around, and I started paying attention more to the emails and everything. And my kids actually ended up becoming victims of bullying at school. My kids were 5 and 6 being bullied in school, okay? Mm-hmm. it boggled my mind. So I started realizing, because I was homeschooled, and I started realizing how serious the issue is and how pretty much it's not like how it was when I was growing up. And I realized more people needed to be, they needed to come out more, because we have so much power, it's ridiculous. And I see so many of us in this entertainment business in it. And I tell people all the time that sometimes, whether you want to talk to this person or not, I mean, unless they're being downright crazy or whatever, it doesn't take nothing but for you just to respond and be like, hey, what's up, or thank you. A simple thank you is all you got to say, because at the end of the day, if it wasn't for our fans, none of us would have a paycheck. None of us. So, I mean, there's just no way. You can't really film a show without extras. I mean, you can't really sell albums or singles or whatever without fans. It's impossible. Mm-hmm. So
super impossible.
It's right. It's just not going to happen. We all going to be standing in the county line.
Yeah.
So it's just like people just, they start getting that money. And the industry is worse now, because a lot of, the vets, they don't care about us anymore. It's like it's a reality world. They're starting to kind of turn back around, but it's a slow motion. But it's all about reality TV, because they don't have to deal with the union regulations and stuff. And you can find anybody off the street. I can go around the corner, and a person would do whatever just for that, the 5 minutes of fame, 15 seconds, whatever. They will do anything. You can give them a dollar. Hell, you can give them a shirt and they'll be happy. Just so they can be go viral, you know? So it's like the times have changed. So everybody wants to be a celebrity. Morals have gone out the window. So, you know, people want to complain. I'm like, listen to what you guys are rapping about. Listen to what you guys are talking about. The music, like when I used to rap, you already heard my music. So, and I'm not one of those to act like, oh, I was always, you know, Saint Mother Teresa around this mud. I wasn't at all. So, and even if you go back in the archives and find my tracks, okay, I was probably, you know, one of the ones against the rap. But I started realizing how powerful my words were. It wasn't just about, oh, trying to make a, you know, paycheck. I had did a song. It was one of my mixtapes. I had did a song, and it tripped me out. It was a white kid. It hit me up on MySpace. It was talking about how much they loved my music, and it touched them. It was the first time it was Fly So High, because I love Linkin Park. And it was really about my life. My dad had gotten killed in a car accident. Police were chasing a suspect, and he ran the red light and totaled my dad's car. And I was, you know, rapping about that. I was rapping about, you know, just what was going on with the industry in my life. And somebody was like, yo, that really touched me. And, you know, I had suicidal issues, and I rapped about that. And when they sent me the message that they sent me, I was like, wow, I really got to be careful what I rap about. Mm-hmm. Because people are really listening to me. And it's not just a black kid. It's every walk of life is actually listening to little old me and what I'm saying. So I could be like, bang, bang, shoot them up. Nothing against anyone that does that. But bang, 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 shoot them up. And they're probably going to do it. Which is kind of what's happening, because you got these rappers talking about lean, and Molly and all this other stuff, and these kids are doing it. You know what I'm saying? You catch me outside, all this stuff, everybody thinks is cool. But if you had more people rapping about kings and queens and get your degree and graduate and respect or whatever, I'm pretty sure things would change a little bit, you know, because it's all about programming. And that's one reason why I've always loved Bone Thugs. Like, I grew up listening to Bone Thugs, The Brat, and TLC. Even though Bone rapped about what they rapped about, they still had Change the World. They had all of that. Like, they had purpose to their shit. You know what I'm saying? So, it makes a big difference. But, you know, I keep on talking. I'm going to give the mic back to you.
Definitely. And I can attest to that. Bone grew out of it, you know, when they started putting out Resurrection and a few of the older ones like that, Thug World Order. And they, like, changed the world, like you said. And, yeah, Phil Collins, Take Me Home.
Like, come on now. But that's why the industry started hating on them, though, because they weren't rapping about that crazy stuff. The minute they started trying to be positive and really change the world, then that's when the industry really started hating. It was like, oh, wait a minute, hold on, we're not gonna play your video.
Right. Yeah, that's crazy though. And you see how long it took Common to win an award. He's been on that conscious tip for so long, and he finally got an award like 2 years ago.
Right. Like every even when they went solo, each one of them all had purpose. Even with Crazy's last album, we listened to that. My son and my daughter love the song, because it's so crazy. If you listen to the song, it's pretty much talking about everything that's going on right now. Mm-hmm. If you listen to any of the songs from their album, they were so far into the future. It's happening right now.
Yes, indeed.
Right. That's probably a whole
other
show.
Oh yeah. We'll have to keep this one going on another time.
Right.
Alright, so an ongoing topic is how do child or teenager actors are supposed to transition their careers when they begin to grow up. If you do it too soon, of course you lose fans, endorsements, deals, work, and can get major flack. But if you do it too late, you just might miss your appropriate fan base, deals, work, and even a part of yourself, because you're not able to be yourself. And there are countless of actors and artists that go through these things. But what path did you choose, and what was the outcome, and how you were able to handle everything?
So for like almost 15 years, I tried playing by the book. Playing it by the book did nothing for me. I still got screwed. So I pretty much, like I said, when I ended up having my kids, I pretty much was like, F it. You know, like, it's already F me as it is. So what more y'all gonna do to me?
Right, right.
So it's like, I'd rather as well be true to myself and everybody else. And especially when I realized people were really paying attention to me, and I was really affecting people in a positive way. That's why they were opening up to me, because it was like, dang, like, she's one of us. Like, they, you know, some of the celebrities, not going to say any names, they act like they untouchable. Ain't none of us untouchable. Believe that. Every last one of us can get touched.
That's right.
You know, so, I, like, it was pretty much just life. Like, you know, I tried to play it by the book. You know, I was tiptoeing. I was on eggshells. Like, maybe if I just, you know, tiptoe around this corner, maybe, you know, they'll go ahead and let me get this role. You know, maybe I'll do this. Maybe I'll, you know, 15, almost 20 years later. If it wasn't for the fans, it would probably still be at me. But because of how social media is, the studio cannot really control it anymore the way that they were able to before social media crashed. Social media and the internet is so powerful right now. Like, you can become a celebrity just off an Instagram page.
You're right.
I mean, what's a celebrity? Because you might have a rapper deal. You feel me?
It's
like, you can't control it anymore. So if it wasn't for the fans resurrecting us, like, and there's no telling what I would be doing right now, because they definitely did play a hand in me slowly, I guess, you know, people like, well, where is she? And I, I've always been there, but, you know, it wasn't checking.
Definitely.
And I was like, oh, yeah. Here, overnight. No, I've always been there. There was a reason why you wasn't seeing me like that.
Yeah, it's funny you say that, because the production companies and, you know, the big wigs, they used to control mass appeal, mass decisions. But when the internet, you know, social media broke loose, it's like they can't control millions of thoughts. And they just can't control it anymore when they used to control it. But now it's out of their hands. And with that, nowadays, you know, the internet is watching every move. And it's having a positive impact on others, something that you might always wonder about. Because I know you want to be true to yourself, but, you know, we're not all saints all the time.
No. That's where people mess up, though. They stand there trying to act like, you know, they saints and everything. Please. Mm-hmm. And one thing I've learned about the internet, if you dig deep enough. Just a little bit. Type in the right word, you can find everything.
Yep.
So, you know, sooner or later, everybody's got skeletons in their closet. Some just, you know, bury them a little bit better than others. But at the end of the day, it's going to come out regardless. Whether it's on your deathbed or whatever, it's like, it's going to come out.
Definitely.
That's the truth.
So in media, and even, you know, being an independent journalist, I still find myself, though, censoring myself. I have no boss or producers trying to pull the plug, you know, because of my views or opinions that I may say openly. But I personally think that most people these days are just super sensitive, and I tend to walk on eggshells. But I'm sure you can attest to, you know, that being who you are. But do you struggle with it? Like, can you go on Twitter or your Instagram and dump on Trump, or vice versa, show support for Trump without losing anything? Or better yet, can you be an advocate or supporter of the Black Lives Matter movement and still save face with fans but lose work with those production companies? How do you handle all that?
See, if you had asked me that like 15-20 years ago, I probably was like, oh, you know, yeah, you know, don't do that, you know, playing about the book. When I say my whole mentality is like so different, like two middle fingers to the sky. Like, if you don't like what I have to say, unfollow me. Point blank, because like I said, I've been kicked the ball down. Like, mm-hmm. when you've been through so much and treated a certain way for so long, you too will get tired and just not care what people think anymore.
Right.
Because you've been at the bottom. I've been at the bottom. I was at the top, and I've been at the very bottom. So what mm-hmm. more can you really do to me? What more can you take from me?
Right.
I've got me. So, you know, there's nothing that anybody can do. So, yeah, first of all, I do not support him at all. I can't even say the name. But I can't even believe we're in this situation. Like, I'm still baffled by it. But, you know, I will say, if you go on my page, it's very clear that I don't support him at all. Like, it's definitely not hidden. But with anybody in general, they always recommend it's kind of best just not to be completely political. Which, whether it was Obama, whether it was Bush or whatever, they've been saying that for years, which is very true. In this situation, though, it's just like he's doing so much crazy ish, like it really had me looking at followers that I like personally knew, because I feel like you just put all of our lives in jeopardy. So I feel some kind of way about that, because I'm like, y'all weren't even thinking. And some of them even, they were just like, so like horses with blindfolds on their face, like, oh, well, he said he's going to do this. Oh, like, no, he don't even have any experience. And he just admitted it. He just admitted it about a week ago or less than a week ago. It just, he thought it was going to be a lot easier. Bro, did y'all really? For real.
Right.
Did y'all really? The man just admitted he thought it was going to be easier. Then what just happened today? Like, that's insane. But not you, but y'all voted that in. I did the poll. I was working the poll. There were so many people that it became a race issue. Everybody wants to be like, oh, it's not about race. Bullshit. You know my language. Bullshit, okay? I saw it and witnessed it at the poll. There were specific people that were coming in straight because they just did not want her to win at all. They didn't care who it was. They didn't care about anything else on the ballot, which is why other stuff got passed, because everybody was just focused on one thing. But they just were like, it was so clear it was a race issue. And it's frustrating because I see the behind the scenes. People on social media, they just see what the media wants them to see. But I end up seeing behind the scenes. I see on top. I see below. I see in, like, I see everything, because that's just, I'm one of those kind of people. And then some people don't even, you know, pay attention to their third eye. That's a whole other different show. But, you know, it's just like, why be quiet? And you know what? I kind of want to know if I got snakes in my garden. I don't want anybody being fake with me. I've had snakes around me for almost 15, 20 years.
Yeah.
And still got some around me. So, you know what? If me being real is what it is, and that's going to get rid of y'all, cool. I'm glad. Because I'm going to get around to cut you out anyway. But go ahead and remove yourself. And like I said, y'all blackballed me anyway. what you really going to do? Yeah, no, I don't like him. and I make it very clear. But I am mindful because, you know, some of the people that I know that did vote him in, they're not racist, even evil. They're just dumb as hell. We just have a lot of people, though, unfortunately, that are like that. They only pay attention to what media puts in front of them, or they don't do the research, and they call that a
top. Yeah.
You know? So,
that is
unfortunately,
so frustrating.
Yeah, we know a lot of stupid people. I get it. But, you know, unfortunately, a lot of those stupid people are in a little bit of higher positions, and I'm not going to be completely dumb about it, but it's very clear. Like, there's levels to it. Don't go overboard, especially if you still try to work in this industry. Whatever it is, whether you're working for a company, okay, and you know the CEO, let's just say, is a supporter, don't go in there with the F Trump shirt on. Come on now. Like, but...
you're asking for it.
Right, we already know how that's going to work. We're not going to sit here and run into the middle of a KKK rally. Like, we already know what's going to happen, but I'm not about to sit here and lie anymore, because when I was trusting people and I needed people to have my back, they didn't have my back. So it's like, ask me, you know? So it's like, I'm going to be me. If you can't accept it, it is what it is. And like, when it comes to that, yeah, no, everybody knows where I stand. I've had to go off on a couple, and I've had to block them because some were just like, the evilness is just ridiculous. And it came from even the last person I had to block, he was black. And he, but it seemed like his thing, it seemed like the reason why he voted was just to get a rise out of people. Because everything he was saying, it was like, oh, you're mad, huh? You're pissed now. And I'm like, okay, what? You're one of them people. Mm-hmm. Right, so you could tell every statement. I mean, he was darker than us. Me and you combined, he was darker. And I was just like, bruh, really? But I'm like, but that's on you, though. Because I hate to be, you know, the party pooper. It's going to affect every single body. There's not one person that's not about to get hit.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, but I've learned, this is what I have learned, not to try to change anybody's mind because stupid is stupid does. People, when they are set in their ways, I tell everybody this, stop arguing with a dumb person because then people get confused on who the stupid person is.
Good one.
Like, I used to be that person. I'm like, no. And this is because they're not stupid. They're not that stupid. Like, they know that they effing up. They know it. But because we have a lot of narcissistic people, they just want to see you get a rise. Mm-hmm. And the fact that you're like, going back and forth, it's making them happy. Because everybody's passed up or whatever it is. So I've learned not to even debate them. Like, I'll say what I have to say because my page, I don't know if you've noticed, I have a very peaceful page. For
yes.
The most part.
Yes.
There's no wretchedness. I've gone off a couple people that, you know, repost stuff. Either I've removed it or, you know, I'm telling them, like, you know, everyone don't post nothing on my page at all. They don't do it. Like, I don't have crazy followers like that. But every now and then, somebody will pop off, and then what ends up happening is my followers, or I can't even call them followers because on Facebook, like, everybody almost feels like family. Like, everybody I talk to, even though I might not remember your name, I remember your face. So I pretty much know every single follower that's on my page right now, which is another reason why my supporters love me, because it's like, they be like, oh, you probably don't remember yet. I'm like, no, I remember you. I met you off of Twitter. I met you off of MySpace.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody else really does that. I just remember because I don't talk to everybody. I don't accept everybody. So you might have this one person that's talking crazy. Now you just had my whole page come to my defense, and now everybody's talking reckless. You just completely screwed up the whole aura of my page. I don't like that. So I do try to, like, keep it at a minimum because, yo, you post some crazy ish on my page and you come at me crazy, I can't stop what my supporters are going to do. Boy, they go hard on Facebook. So I love it.
Oh, yeah.
Man, they go hard.
I can imagine. Yeah.
Man.
All right, here's another heavy one for you. So here's one thing that always worried me, and I believe in honesty through music, media, and this acting thing that we do, and you're here to set all these records straight. So let's talk about this in open. A lot of people know my struggle, which is sad, with the relationship with my with money and art. I have a hard time putting a price tag on anything that I do for a friend, and it can get me to a point where I'm really worked up and can barely breathe about it. And now we know that money can dissolve even relationships between friends and family. This is one of those moments where I have to hope for the best in an answer. Maybe I can jot down some notes from you, but I think it's safe, you know, to ask you because you're the right type of personality. So let's set the record straight. You're a given person. You're a humanitarian, for Christ's sake. But
right.
How do you balance the two, making a living or losing a friend or family member over, you know, the to charge or not to charge choice?
You know, I've been dull. I'm one of those that learned from trial and error.
Ah.
Like, I will give and give and give and give until I just can't give anymore. And then after being just drained and the person's gone, whether it's family or friends, I'm sitting there like still reaching and they are skipping my moves. Like they doing something else. So, you can only burn me so many times, seriously, before I'm just like, F it and, you know, I'm done. I've gotten a lot better with how quick I am to cut you off, though. Like, it's not, no, I don't try to be like, oh, well, you know, they're really a good person. I know that they really needed it, or you know, they really, if it wasn't for this situation, they would be okay. Like, I stopped trying to save everybody.
Mm-hmm.
That was me. I was the saver, you know, because I just knew. I just know how you really are. People just didn't understand, you know, and that left me in a ditch so many times. And I was left in that ditch with nobody trying to help me. Like, I can really count on one hand how many people have actually tried to help me and on one hand actually know what's really, really, really going on in my life. But I know almost everybody in this industry.
Mm.
I know people who are A-list, B-list, C-list, D-list. I know people who are behind the scenes. I know people who were just, you know, on stage winning awards. I know everybody. I hear that all the time. Angie, you know everybody. Everybody knows you. I say, yeah, everybody knows me. That don't mean nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and there's nothing. When people are like, oh, it's all about who you know. No, it's not. Because I know everybody.
Right.
You know, so, you know, people will just take. They don't take your giving. Like, who's really, like, if someone's just doing this stuff, you really going to be like, no, man, don't give me that. You really rarely run into somebody that's going to just be like, you know, I'm good. And that goes to family sometimes. Oh, my God, family can be worse. Like, my family, I love them. I love every last one of them. But some of them, I can't talk to like that. I literally have to keep them at a distance because they've all got stuff going on in their life. And whether people want to admit it or not, you cannot be around negativity without it rubbing off on you.
Mm-hmm. True that.
I got enough issues in life going on where I don't need somebody else's issues. I'm blessed. Yes, true enough. But I've got enough of my own stuff going on where I don't need to be dealing with my cousins, sisters, blah, 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 you know, ex-husband, ex-wife. I don't need to be dealing with all that. The third cousin down the line that's all the way in God knows where. Like, I don't need to be dealing with their issues. Like, people just like to doubt it. Feel me? So it's like, you just let them do what they do. And then there's some family members and friends that they just like drama. It's almost like they just like to always have some kind of issue going on where they just have to, just so they can call. Girl, guess what happened today? Or guess what's going on? Just to be talking, you know? Like, that's life, and I've learned that. So it goes with money. Like, I used to, my mom, we've had our issues, whatever, but for the most part, my mom, she's very caring. For the most part, like, if you're family, she will give you the shirt off your back without her being okay. And it used to frustrate me because I'm like, yo, you always got to take care of yourself. Because I said, if you're not okay and you just gave them the house, the shirt off your back, your shoes and everything, and they good, and they've gone wasted, now you out in the open with nothing. But the family is good now. But now nobody's helping you.
Yeah.
You know, so I've learned from trial and error and watching my mama, too. You know, like I said, everybody's family. There is nobody's family that's perfect. I don't give a damn who you are. I don't care how many reality shows you got, how many makeup lines and clothing lines you got. Nobody's family is perfect.
Right.
But everybody has those, their skeletons a little bit differently, and I just choose to keep my skeletons at bay. But you know what? Some of them think that I'm, you know, some of them think I'm a B. Hey, maybe I am. But, you're not. I got kids. That's the whole thing people don't realize. Once you become a parent, nothing else. So you're not about to stress me out, which is because kids are going to stress you out regardless. So your stress is not about to add on to the stress of my kids already stressing me out. And you're not about to be taking money from me. Now, if you are about to become homeless or something, or your child doesn't have somewhere to sleep, or your child needs food or whatever, then yeah. But I've seen people that would just be like, oh, yo, let me hold this, let me hold that. Like, no, for what? You have the same 24 hours that I got.
Like,
what you doing? Some don't even have kids. What are you doing? What you doing with your money? That's not my problem. I'm not sleeping with you. So what? That's where I'm at with it. You know, as like I said, with what I went through, it just really... it really hardens my heart. You know, like, I used to be, like, really caring, just, like, I mean, I still am, but it really hardened me a lot. Like, I was really, like I said, I would give you the shirt and everything and just be, like, okay, and be give you my leg and still be, like, trying to drag myself on the ground with my arms. You know, you need an arm, too. Well, here's an arm. Now I don't got no arm, so I'm wiggling now.
Mm-hmm.
And not even getting anything back in return. You know, it's they say tough love, but, you know, I don't know what it's called, but it's just like, you just, at the end of the day, you got to worry about yourself. Because when you need someone to worry about you, no one's around. And like I said, I've seen it up close and personal more than once.
Right.
Like, don't give a damn until you on top.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
You know? Yeah.
Man, that was good. That was good. So some people may not know this, but you're also known as Alizé.
Yeah,
Alizé.
When my publicist sent me that, I said, yo, he knows me.
Yeah. And this is the crazy part, though. The reason why I know about you being an artist is because Lazy Bone pointed to you. And they say, yo, she raps. And I was like, no, that's the chick from all of that. Her name's Angelique. No, I don't know that. She raps. He's like, yeah, you do know that. You know that show. This is her. He's like, no, yo, kid. No, she raps. Check it out. So a lot of people don't know, like, MySpace was a real thing, you know, a few years ago before Facebook and Twitter was popping off. MySpace was the place to go. And even they try to resurrect it back in, what, 2010, 2011? So I'm on the internet. Yeah. So I'm on the internet, like, going through MySpace, and I found you. Like, all those instrumentals you were rapping over. I think there was, like, this UK mixtape, a So-So Death mixtape that was floating around at the time.
So-So Death and Slip and Slide Records.
Yes. So I'm listening to the records, and I'm like, oh, man, oh, snap, she does rap. I said, and she likes, you know, Bone, because you, like, you posted, like, pictures with Bone t-shirts, shotting them out all the time. I was like, oh, it's a match made in heaven. Thank you, Lazy.
Right.
Like, wow. Come to Cali more often. So on one of these tracks, though, you shouted out Dre Goes, and everyone in our camp, or the Bone camp, that is, knows Dre Goes and what he meant and did for Bone back in the East 99 days, and still today on various projects. So my question, though, is, now, when I first checked into your music, I thought it was going to be like jokes, you know, it was going to be like songs about broccoli people or mushroom people, you know, it was going to be jokes. But no, it was real live stuff going on. Like, your life unfolding on these, you know, through these lyrics. What made you, you know, choose that approach versus jokes?
Well, I mean, I always wanted to be an artist. Growing up, like, a lot of people didn't know, like, I could actually sing if I really wanted to. I didn't pursue it, so, you know, I haven't had vocal classes and everything. Like, my voice might crack a little bit now. But I used to be singing recitals. You know, music was always my love. I just ended up booking all that, you know? So, even, a lot of people don't even know this. When DeBrat used to come through, they had a A&R. And she kind of helped groom me. Like, I was so cold with it, it was crazy. Okay, so you remember the karaoke, the original karaoke machines that they used to have, right? With the cassette tape, the double cassette tape. Okay, so my mama had one, right? So I would play with it at the house. And I remember the Brett A&R was like, you know, just, you know, send me the demos or whatever, and I would critique it. So every year, well, I mean, I was only on the show for 2 years. So for like 2 years, I would send her a demo, probably like twice a year, maybe. And she would critique it. The first demo I ever sent out, it was the funniest shit ever. I didn't even have an instrumental. I was just rapping. It was cassette tape. Like, I would put one cassette tape and rap over that. Those would be my ad-libs. Then I would put it on the other side, put the other blank tape, and rap over the ad-lib. Like, it was crazy, but I didn't have no music. So I remember when I sent the first demo, she was like, you know, I love your lyrics, but you gotta have music. So I was like, oh. So that's how I would go to Blockbuster, and you know, they had the little music section, and I would go to the warehouse. Because Blockbuster, sometimes, even though they was all movies, sometimes you would luck up and find singles. But it was like, I don't know, like, if it was the, you know, the soundtrack or whatever, but you would find the single. So I would do the single, record it over the blank tape, and oh, it was crazy. So she was actually, I remember one time she asked, and she was like, how are you recording? I said, on the karaoke. And she was like, whoa. But she literally would critique everything. So I was pretty much getting critiqued by Social Death. And right when it was good enough, Social Death kind of, I guess, fell off. You know, that was when they took that break. So they weren't taking any more artists. Like, I molded myself after Bone Thugs and Harmony and The Brat and Laugh God. Those right there, I used to sit every single day and listen to Bone Thugs and Harmony. And literally, I printed up the lyrics and all that and would literally just rap over their lyrics and just rap, and keep on rapping as fast as possible, ugly up on it, until I had it right
now.
And see, I could never really quite get him down, but Lay Crazy with all them, like, yeah, but like, you know, as far as that momentum, yeah, Busy, like, that was me. So, and then with the rap kicking in, and then Left Eye, that's why when people hear me rap, they be like, some will be like, yo, you remind me of Left Eye. Some will be like, yo, you remind me of The Brat. Others, because of my speed, they would be like, oh, you remind me of Bone, because those were the main three people. So I always wanted to do music, but it was just acting took off. So I tried to steal, which is what I loved about all that, because we had the musical artists, so I was able to have access to the labels. But, you know, what happened. So it kind of like blocked that too. So when I couldn't act, I ended up doing music. And actually my little sister, my place is whatever, but she's, Draco's is her big brother. So we have a friend named Deja Vu. She's a rapper. And she was actually working with Draco. And she was, like I said, I know a lot of people, but nobody was like, you know, Angie, come in the studio, I want you to lay, you know, this verse or whatever. So many people knew I could rap, but Deja Vu was the only one that was like, yo, I'm doing a song, and I want you to get on it. And when that happened, Dre had never met me. I went in the booth, and I killed it. But they called me a one-hit wonder, because I used to be able to just kill it in one take.
What?
I was like, boom, and be done. Like, every now and then, you know, I still can, you know, can, but you know, sometimes you just don't know.
Yeah.
But, you know, especially depending on how high it is in the closet. So, but yeah, I was a one-hit wonder and just kill it. And we just kept on doing tracks. And he ended up being at another studio, and that was pretty much us. We were called Dre's Angels. And we were just, like, kicking out tracks. And I remember I wanted to start making beats because, you know, I would mess around with the piano and everything. And I remember he taught me how to, you know, start producing. And I picked it up in literally one day. And, like, the second day, because there was a lot of other artists that were in the studio, I would be on the, you know, the computer making beats, and they started wanting to rap over my tracks. They'd be like, yo, you know, bump that and kick it out into the studio so we can record it. So it was crazy. Like, I'm a quick learner. And I ended up meeting Bone, I want to say, probably within that year, if not the next year. Because, you know, they used to always be out here when they would be doing their concerts and everything. They would be at the spot.
yep. And they lived out there.
Yeah. All over. But yeah, that one spot where everybody would all meet up after the concerts or their performance or whatever. And I actually remember the first time he didn't know who the hell I was. And I remember he was like, because it was a lot of people that were there. And he, like I said, he didn't know who I was. And I remember he asked me something. I was like, I rap. He looked at me and was like, can you rap? Let me hear something. And I just, you know, because people be asking. And I must have kicked them lyrics. And his whole face was like, what? And from that moment, he was like, yo, this is my little sister. She got flows. And that's how pretty much, you know, he was like, what's your rap name? And I was like, LA. He was like, oh, yeah, this is Zay. And sometimes he'll call me Fire because red is my favorite color. And, you know, if you mess with my big brother, he was about to be problems. Because I'm old school with it. I'm like, if any of my brothers got a problem with a female, then you call one of the females to deal with it. Don't touch the female. So, you know, that's what it was. And from that, he used to be like, you said. He would be like, yeah, she rapping, you know. I would be kicking my little flows and everything. He didn't even know I was on Nickelodeon.
Yeah, that's why I was out. Man, we had an argument. A literal argument. Yeah. He was like, nah, she rap. I was like, nah, man, she's on all that. That's where I know her from. Nah, man, you tripping. She's rap. That's Alizé. Like, man, she's no Alizé. She's angelique-bates.
He didn't really realize I was who I was until years later. Like, I've known him for almost, God, it seemed like 20 years. So I would say probably 16 years later. That's when it's like, it finally grabbed, like, whoa, like, you really are that person.
Yeah.
You think it was crazy? Because I just, it was crazy because his publicist contacted me because I knew his publicist because she used to rap my ex-boyfriend's cousin, who was a boxer, a celebrity boxer. So me and her, that's how we met. But for this last album that Crazy did, he reached out to her and asked her if I would be interested in shooting one of the commercials for the album.
Wow.
And, dude, when I got that call, I was like, hell yeah. It was crazy. I ended up being on his radio show. So I was just like, It was just so crazy because I'm like, and I told him, I said, man, I grew up with y'all. Y'all helped me get through a lot of stuff. Like, if it wasn't for music and for them in particular, just the words and just like, I don't even know, like, how life would have turned out. And, you know, just to even have them as big brothers and influence and just like, I can reach out to them and be like, if it's really a problem, I can reach out to them. You know, and I'm forever grateful for that. But, they, I even got a cool story. When I was pregnant with my son, when they were doing Uni. That album. I remember I walked out back because that's where my car was. And he was like, praying. I was like, yeah. And he put his hand on my stomach and started praying over my baby.
Wow.
And I thought that was like the dopest thing ever.
Yeah.
And it was just like, you know, just to bless my baby like that. And I was just like, man, like people don't even realize how genuine and real they are, you know what I'm saying? It's different when you're like actually in his family. So yeah, but they definitely influence. But I mean, music is really something that I've always wanted to do. I've never wanted to stop, but it's just like, it's so many politics, you know, with music too, like especially when you a female and if you don't have the right connect, like with Dre, like I appreciate it, the fact that he, you know, brought me into the camp and everything, because he was one of the very few producers that never tried to sleep with me.
Right.
You know, that was the issue I was running into. It was like, oh yeah, you know, we'll record you, but you gotta do this. Like, I had one dude, he didn't even know I was from Nickelodeon. When I had a dude tell me, he didn't know I was from Nickelodeon, he was like, oh. Because he wanted me to change my whole image and everything. And he was like, oh, you ain't never going to make it if you don't rap like Lil' Kim. I was like, I've already made it. I said, you don't even know who I am. But because I look so young, they used to come at me like I was like a young buck, like I was a 15, 16-year-old, but I'm actually 21 years old. And because Bones and Dragos had already put me up on game, you know what I'm saying, what goes on with the music industry, I already know, like, let's just say I had decided to be a little back or whatever. I know that I could, you know, you could easily hit that one little button and just delete my whole verse. It don't make it to the album.
Yep.
So it was just so many politics. It was like, yeah, I would love to be signed to any of Bones' labels. I would love to do a track with them. Like, that's always been one of my dreams. I mean, you know, life ain't over yet, so who knows? It might still happen, but Busy, Lay, and Crazy. I love everybody else, but those three, those are my favorite. Like, if I could do a song with these three, oh my God, you don't even understand how fucking happy I would be.
I'll see what I can do on that end, especially with Busy. I don't really work with Lazy. I never worked with Lazy. I was just, you know, friends with him. But I definitely work for Busy and see if I'll see what I can do. I won't make any promises, but I'll put a bug in their ear.
Right, right. And I'm not gonna hold
you.
Now you said.
Yeah, yeah. Like, hey, where's that feature?
Right. I mean, push comes to show, we live in a world where all I gotta do is just grab the song and make it a mixtape anyway. You know, I can just dub out once a verse and act like I was on it. But you know what's crazy? My single, did you ever hear I Bet with Drago?
No, I didn't.
Dre, that was the very first solo single I did with Drago. On I Bet, there's a sample of Busy and Bone. And Dre did that. So technically, we have a song together.
Yeah. Definitely. No, I haven't heard that one. Wow. I have to get my hands on it.
I have a slide to see. I mean, it's actually, you know, if you go on my YouTube and you just type in Alizé, I bet it'll come up. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm
going to
have to play it tonight.
Okay. I'm definitely finna rock out to it tonight.
All right,
so I know you were in talks about putting out an album around, you know, 2012, 2013. Did it come out or did I miss it by any chance?
Nope, it didn't come out. Politics.
Politics.
You know, so, you know, I mean, if I had, you know, been willing to lay down, you know, all kinds of stuff, it would have been. But I believe in longevity. And like I said, you know, I'm a mom now, dude. Like, all the partying and all that other stuff, acting certain ways. And we in a world of social media, you can find anything. Like, once it hits the internet, it never dies.
Yeah.
So, you know, I wasn't willing to put out, so it didn't get put out. It is what it is. So, you know, and it's like, it was just so many games. And even with the tracks, you know, people wanted to play games with the tracks. You know, I had my supporters. Some of those tracks that you heard were from, well, mine is the ones that were clearly Drago's. But after I was no longer, you know, the at the camp, I had supporters that were sending me tracks. So some of those are from my fans were making them. Like, and it's cold. Like I said, my fans have shown me more love than people I've known for almost 20 years.
That's crazy, right? I never understood how that happens.
Dude, like somebody actually, when I posted about the radio show, somebody actually got under one comment and he was like, I remember LSA. He was like, I sent some tracks back and they're like, yeah, he did. And I actually remember. And I actually remember kicking it on one of the tracks.
Yeah.
You know, but it's just, you know, but see, it was like, even then they would be sending me tracks, but then it was all politics just to get into a studio.
Yeah,
but like, it was like one thing or another. You know, if I had the tracks, then it was like, okay, cool. Now let me just record it. Oh, well, you know, like, it was, man, it was just like one thing after that. I was like, I'm sorry. I was like, you know what? Ain't going to be in this situation forever.
Yeah,
and then when it pops, it is what it is. It's going to take that one time. And I'm wrong.
All right, so we normally don't mention God in our interviews, even though I am a firm believer in God and high power and righteousness.
Right.
You know, unless we
right.
see those type of things on our guest timelines or photos. I did, however, spot a tweet on Twitter about bringing your mother to church about 20 years, after 20 years. Do you want to chat about that?
Yeah, that was crazy. When I say kids are so powerful, dude, if it wasn't because of my kids, she wouldn't have stepped foot in that church. Like, my mom, she is very difficult. If it's something that she don't want to do, she ain't going to do it. She came to church. Actually, you know what? It's crazy because the church that we go to, Kel and his wife, Asian Rachel, got me in that church. Because that's their church. And I had been trying to find a church that had a youth ministry. It had been really hard, and I'm one of those people, like, if I'm not feeling it, like, I can't praise there, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's just, man, I can sense some bullshit, okay? Point blank, period. Like, if there's, the word can be, but the people around, like, the vibe just has to be right. If it's not right, I can't do it. So, you know, I watch it online. It is what it is. But I remember his wife posted the youth ministry. And I was like, what? So I remember I hit her up and I was like, yo, you guys got a youth ministry? Because I had just got baptized. I got baptized last year. Like, that mm-hmm. was fine. Like, I had a feeling that something had just been missing. And I finally did it. I got baptized. And actually, one church LA.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. And when I went in the water, I was not the same person that came out. Like,
awesome.
Definitely feel the difference.
Yeah.
So, less than a week later, you know, like I said, that happened, and we ended up going to the church, and their first time getting ready to perform, you know, I told my mom, I was like, yo, the kids want to perform. It was their first time ever being in a choir in anything, and so she came out to see her baby.
Wow.
And so now, you know, they in the choir, so they perform, so I've gotten her there a couple times, you know? So,
yeah.
Like, so she just went back, because the babies are performing, you know? Those are her grandbabies. She got a grandson and a granddaughter. So, mm-hmm. you know, she gonna come out to him, and they just did their first solo. So, you know, she's been coming, like the pastor said, he was like, you know what, it takes time. But the thing is, every time she comes, she's actually getting the word, and she's, you know, paying the eyes and everything. And I was just like, I had to look at her like, look at you. Like,
wow. Yeah.
Because it was just so big, because my mom's the same way, but she's just so serious. Like, if she ain't feeling it, she don't care. She's not touching anybody's church. At least me, I'm like, okay, well, let me see if I can try to find another church. Like, you know, but she, man, she's not feeling it. So that was so huge. I mean, she believes in God. Like, she, you know, she'll listen to it, like, you know, online or maybe the radio or whatever. I mean, you're still listening to the word, but she, man, 20 years. Probably a little bit over. I feel like it was over 20 years. She was not doing it. And for that to happen, like, it was amazing. It was amazing. You know, a lot of my friends, they're like, man, you really for real like church. Like, some of them thought I was going to fall off, because, I mean, that's really what was happening, because if I wasn't feeling it, I was out. And we just had a church picnic, and I was just like, man, this is crazy. I'm about to church picnic and everything. I've been really for real doing this.
Yeah. Well, I think, like from a spiritual aspect, I think that we all need refilling. Like, if we're constantly giving out energy to this person, to this cause, to this event, we do need some type of refilling. And sometimes church is that thing, even if it's online, even if it's a podcast or an audio book. You know, we all need refilling.
Right. Yes, you're absolutely right. The only time, sometimes I recommend actual church sometimes, is because even when we're at home, because I was going through this, I got kids. I would be trying to listen to it, you know, online or whatever, and the kids are doing whatever they're doing. You're not fully focused.
Yeah, yeah.
So, for that hour, 2 hours, or however long the service is, you have to, well, even though some people do it, technically you should not be on your phone. Technically. and it's, you have, the distractions are gone. So you are forced to actually listen to the word and be quiet for 2 hours or however long the service is. So we don't sit still long enough.
Long
enough. And so we're not going to do it at home, some of us. You know, some of us are more conditioned than others, which I, you know, shout out to those that can do it and can take their time. But not all of us can do it. So, you know, that's why I always be like, you know, if you can find a good church home, and it's a for real one, and it's not no corrupt stuff going on and gossip and all that other stuff. Like, I love my church. No gossip, nothing. If there is anything going on, they keep it to themselves. Like, I don't have no issues with it. It reminds me of when I used to go to West Angeles growing up. Like, that was my home church. So, I was a kid. I'm in my 30s now. And I'm just now finding a church that reminds me of the churches when I was growing up.
Wow.
So that's a lot. You know what I mean?
Like, oh, yeah. It says a whole lot.
You're right. You know? And I pretty much thankfully go almost every Sunday. Every now and then, you know, because work might end up, you know, coming in play or whatever. But every Sunday, for the most part, I am there. Because I need that time. And I thought about this, you know, the last Sunday that I was just like, man. Because every time I'm sitting there, it's like I have to focus. But it's the only time that I really get to myself. which is crazy. And I was thinking about that this week, and I said, this is crazy. The only time I really get to myself and can listen and focus and think about what's really going on with life is here in church. Because I can't do it really on the drive home, because the kids, you know, we listening to Kendrick or whatever is on the radio.
Yeah, then traffic is so backed up all the time on those LA highways.
Right, so even if you was just in a good mood, somebody probably gonna cuss you off, and you there with being holy out the window.
Yeah.
Exactly. But yeah, everybody needs to be a recharge, you know. Everybody needs that quiet time, and everybody has that phone in hand. Like I'm guilty of that. Guilty of that.
All right, so we could tell by your photos that you're one proud mom. And what is one of the best things that you learned about your children's growing personality?
Oh my gosh, they love their mama, and they're really caring. They love to give back, and they want to be like their mama. And it's like, no matter what anyone else may think in their eyes, I'm amazing. Mm-hmm. Like, I could be, hair could be all over the place. Whatever. And they're like, you're so beautiful. And I'm looking at them like, yeah, right. You know, like, look, you're looking crazy. But children are so innocent. They're so pure. It's like, it doesn't matter. Like, they see the good regardless. They're not tainted yet, you know? So it's just to look at them, it's like, it's crazy. And they've actually taught me a lot of patience. Like, you know, sometimes, you know, something might have me a little upset or impatient, and my son will be like, okay, just breathe. And like, he'll do like this little comment, I gotta stop and look at him like, where did you get that from? Even when his sister is like about to have a tantrum, he'll be like, okay, it's cool, just breathe. And I can't even bust up a laugh. I'm like, wait a minute. But it's just patience. But he be right. Stop. Breathe. Breathing is amazing. You have no idea all the miracles that happen when you breathe.
Yeah.
Yeah, the kids are definitely, they're something. Full of surprises. And learning lessons if you're willing to learn.
Do you feel like they will follow in a similar path as the one you chose growing up?
Well, my son, he's in the industry. My daughter, she kind of likes it or whatever. She likes to dance, and but I think she'll probably be more of an artist or a musician.
Cool.
Yeah, like, because they go to art class and everything, and actually art runs in my family. So they're dope. Like, they were just in class, and it was their first time. Well, they've been going to art class, but it was a different form. It was just like, you know, stencil and chalk, whatever. I haven't gone to a new school, and it's my homeboy's wife, and who actually I met through Lazy. Crazy how everything comes full circle. His wife is a dope artist, and she uses Canvas. And it was my kid's first time dealing with Canvas, and they were getting ready to sit here and draw like cows. I was like, oh my god. So they're both dope. Like, my son though, like, he's been he was in Big Sean's music video. It hasn't came out like yet. It's the light one. He was Little Gip at the Gip at CeeLo. I forget what the name of that video was, but Fatima is the one who actually picked him.
Wow.
The choreographer. So it's like, you know, he's been blessed. Like, he don't even, when he gets older, he's gonna look back and it's like, dang. But yeah. I've always been around legends, and those legends are around him, so he don't even realize like how much, you know, knowledge that he's been given, and you know how many people look out for him because of me. So he wants to do it. I would prefer him to not be a Nickelodeon kid, but you know, it is what it is. If it ends up happening, it ends up happening, I'm trying to deter from it happening. But you know, there's projects and networks that are looking at him right now. So you know, whatever God has in store, we'll just ride with it. But he likes it, and I always ask him, like, you want to do it? You like it? He's like, yeah. the minute he says he don't want to do it, he's out. Point blank period. Yeah. It is what it is. Mm-hmm. Because the thing is, I have him doing so much other stuff that he's always going to be okay. He does coding. He does artwork. He plays flag football. I'm not really one for the sports because, you know, I don't feel like that's anything can go wrong. The minute you get hurt, it's done. You know, you always got to have a backup, you know, plan. I used to run track in college, so I get it. So I'm not really one for the riding and then, you know, trying to live off the sports, but I have him doing other things. So he's always going to be good. If he wants to be an artist, if he wants to do coding, do graphics or whatever, he's always going to be good. He's not going to be in a position where he's like, dang, like how I felt growing up. This is all I know how to do.
Right, right.
He's not going to, him or my daughter, they're not going to feel trapped. So they, like I said, they already, you know, they are trying to follow my footsteps. They didn't realize who I was until we did all that reunion, the kamikaze, this last one, and they were sitting on stage off on the side, and they saw how many people there were, and they saw their mama on the big screen.
Yeah.
They had no idea.
Wow. I bet that was some experience.
Oh, man. Like, yeah, they still, like, they get it, but they don't get it.
Yeah.
Because people be like, do you realize who your mama is? And it's like, yeah, of course. And they're like, nah, do you really realize who your mama is?
Right.
Like, my son, I've had to opt out and let my son take certain pictures. Like, he got a picture with Stevie Wonder. I don't even have a picture with Stevie Wonder. Like, he don't, like I said, when they look back, they going to be like, dang.
Yeah, all that was a pinnacle.
Man,
and,
yeah,
you know,
I mean,
and the work you can continue to do after that.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, you know, I ended up doing Tim and Eric. That was crazy. When I did the Tim and Eric show, I didn't even realize what kind of show that was. When they hired me, they didn't hire me as the girl from All That. They had a casting. I was pregnant with my daughter. They wanted a pregnant woman. That was the breakdown. Pregnant late.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember my agent at the time, he didn't even know I was pregnant again. I forgot to even tell him, to be quite honest. So that just shows you I wasn't really going out on auditions like that. So I had submitted myself on it. And the callback, they contacted him. But it threw him off because he's like, yeah, you got a callback, but they said you're pregnant. And I was like, oh, yeah, my bad. I forgot to tell you, but I'm about to probably go into labor in another week or so anyway. So he was like, wait a minute. Like, you've been pregnant this whole time. I didn't know. I was like, well, shit, you wasn't sending me out or anything, so you wouldn't know. But when I went and I did it, I thought that was it. I had no idea the Tim and Eric show had a cult following like they did.
Oh, it is so huge.
Yo, like, it was nuts. Like, I ended up, I think I had searched my name or something. I don't know what it was that I was doing. I did something. And all these YouTube videos came up. It was little girls, little girls, in front of the TV with me on the TV, and they're singing the Bub Bub song.
The Bub Bub song.
Grown men at work on YouTube singing the Bub Bub song. Grown
trying
men
to do the dance.
Right, like, it was nuts. So Bub Bub, like, it was so crazy because, like, in the comments, you would, under, you know, Comedy Central, they'd be like, some would be like, yo, that chick looks like the girl from All That. Then would be like, wait a minute, that chick looks like the Bub Bub. So now it's like they're starting to cross because, like I said, Tim and Eric didn't realize I was that chick from Nickelodeon. Like, they really was hiring a pregnant chick, and it took on a whole nother life. And they're actually doing their, I think it's a 10-year anniversary right now, tour or something. So, you know, who knows? They might bring back some characters. I don't know. That would be pretty dope to resurrect Bub Bub, maybe. But it's just, I have people. I was at a restaurant, and it was this girl. Her boyfriend loves me as the Bub Bub. And she was like, oh, my God, my boyfriend loves you. Can I please call him right now? And can you do the Bubba song? It was like the craziest thing. I was like, whoa. Like, I thought she recognized me for All That. But she was like, him and Eric. I was like, oh.
Yeah.
Okay. It's like everything I've gotten, I wasn't hired as the girl from All That. They ended up finding out after the fact because my supporters went nuts. Like, oh, snap, she's in it. Even when I did 35 and Ticket with Kevin Hart and Mike Epson and Megan Good, they were like, I was gangster girl. People were watching that movie and was like, yo, like my friends didn't even know. The minute that movie came out, everybody hit me. Even when Ray started, he was just like, what? Because I was really his, he never saw All That. You're not going to see Lay in the thing in front of All That. Like, that was
yeah.
35 and Ticket, they looked, they was like, what? You really be doing your thing? Like, everybody didn't realize it until it just took on another life, and then everybody would be hitting me up. That line was so classic. Like, to this day, people would just come up under one of my pictures and say that line. Because I'm the girl from All That. But when I was hired, it wasn't like, oh, let's get the girl from All That. They really just thought, oh, we're getting gangster girl. Oh, we're getting a pregnant lady.
Yeah.
You know, but it is what it is. You know, the industry's funny.
Yeah. But All right, Angelique, I just want to say thank you again for doing this interview with us. We really enjoy learning more about you, your music, and I know I'll be listening to more of it often from here on in because I still do bump those older tracks on MySpace. I actually got them on YouTube now. Yeah. And I want other people to join me in these moments and let us have a kumbaya moment and listen to Alizé. But we always open this part of the segment. We call it the open floor here at the end of the interviews where you can say anything that you like, shout out whomever or whatever you want. I definitely recommend, like, you know, letting people know where they can link up with you. Once again, thank you. The floor is now yours.
Well, you know, I want to thank you guys for having me on the show. I got to give a shout out to all my supporters that, you know, they're riding with me. Definitely got to give a shout out to my fam, bam, my kids, God, you know, I feel like I'm accepting an award and everything. What's up, Danger? Keith, Mercedes, my cousin, you know, my mama, the milkman. You know, you can find me on, Twitter. You can find me on MySpace, YouTube, Instagram. And you can pretty much find me on anything. Angelique Bates. Just Google it. You're not being stuck up. No, seriously, Google it. Because like I said, there's some other stuff that I'm on. If it's verified for the most part, that's probably me. Instagram's not verified yet. We're working on that. But that's me. I, for the most part, I'll respond back. If you don't come with any craziness, I'll respond back. But you know, just I want to thank everybody for supporting me and those that have been riding for me and have had my back. One person out for real that I had to give a shout out to is my brother Ernest. Like, he's from Nottingham PR Group, and he definitely, when no one else may have, he definitely looked out for me. Matter of fact, you know, he's the reason why I was in the assist with Tammy Romaine from Basketball Wives, which is on Amazon, and the reason why I just did the Bonnet Chronicles with her. So it's like whenever he can help me, he's always making sure that I'm straight. And the Cherry, you know, Cherry Johnson. Yeah, you know, that's pretty much it. I got a long list of people, and I know people are just, you didn't say my name. Dude, I know. Like I said, I know too many people. It is what it is.
Yeah.
But y'all know I love it. Those that are my aces, I love y'all. So, you know, we got this. 2017, you know, we got this. 2018, all that.
All that.
All that. No pun intended.
No pun intended.
Oh, but make sure y'all check out Cash Out. I forgot Cash Out too. My son is in that. Google it. Follow Mary of MVP and Mary Maltry on Instagram and check it out. It's definitely a movie that you guys need to watch. It harps on the industry, how everybody's getting fake implants, people not accepting. Being black, we want to make this and like Cash Out 2, which is what my son is in. It's talking Cash Out 2 morals. You know, it's pretty much people selling out. So make sure you guys Google that. Cash Out and Cash Out 2. Mary Maltry and Kareem Grimm, they actually they directed it. They grew up the whole movie. Like, it's super dope. When you see the quality of it, you would think they had a budget. And actually, the screening is going to be this month. So make sure y'all check that out. I had to plug that.
Awesome. All right, guys, after the music break, it'll be time for our usual tradition. It is called the hot seat, and our fans love this part of the segment. And of course, along with the actual interview, but the audience get to hear either some vocals, a poem, inspirational speech, maybe some written work, spoken word, freestyle raps, maybe they recite lyrics, a joke or two, or a story, or live instruments from our special guests. Well, you never know what these creative minds and vessels will produce in the spotlight. And tonight, we'll find out if Angelique Bates, aka Alizé, have what it takes to be put on the spot, a test of her true artistry, and maybe even some hidden talents. So I have something queued up just for you guys. It's this Alizé Can't Fade Me Now. Let's get it.
Thank God.
Guys, we are back again. That was Alizé with Can't Fade Me Now. I encourage you guys to purchase that off of iTunes like I just did. because we do show support here on the show, right? Yes. And also check out the music video, is rocking. I was over here jamming out, bouncing off the walls. You know what it is. So, you know, we've been talking about artist managers, like what it is. So we don't really cover the entire segment in the podcast because, you know, we don't want to keep our guests waiting that long. But I just want to tell you guys that an artist manager, also known as a band manager, is in charge of the business side of being in a band. Often band members are great at the creative side of things, but aren't so great at promoting themselves, booking their own gigs, or negotiating deals in a very general sense. So the task of a manager is to take care of the day-to-day running of the business career so the band can focus on the creative side of things. So you ask Dini, what job should an artist manager do? Well, if you're signed, the job a manager does depends very much on the band, where they are in their careers or artists. Actually, for the unsigned artist, a manager should send out demos to labels, radio stations, local print media, and online publications. Book gigs, invite labels and medias to shows and performances, network and talk to people about the band, help book studio time, practice sessions, explore funding opportunities for the artist. If you're signed, your manager should negotiate financial deals for the label for expenses like touring and recording, and oversee other people working for the band like accountants or agents and merchandisers. Next podcast, we'll get into more about artist management. So, for now, though, let's bring back Alizé. I like saying that. For our hot seat segment. What do you have for us tonight?
You know what? They already heard me rap because of the song, so I'll probably do some poetry.
Okay, cool.
Alright, so, you know, it's written. So if I stumble a little bit, it's because it's written. Alright, so. Ironically, it's called Black Lives Matter. Okay, so. Black Lives Matter, so they say. Yet it seems like open season to kill a nigga. Almost taking it back to pick a nigga, a.k.a. the real true meaning of picnic days. Blood splattered through the streets. Church halls, precinct walls like Picasso. Blood on the leaves dripping down like a spectacle for the whole world to see. Ripping off the saturated white sheets, revealing the true enemies underneath. Protect and serve is what was taught to me. Overlooking the black tiny writing, restrictions may apply if colored. I can't breathe. I can't breathe. As society tightens its grip around my neck as I try to elevate back to my higher being and regain my rightful place on my throne next to my king. Enough to live, enough to feed your seeds with the milk from me. Leave my children screaming and begging for me as you beat and strip my man, my king, of his pride and dignity. The shackles didn't disappear. The millennium of slavery, bonded by technology, fashion, and TV, distracted from the things we should see, aimed at the temples as blood oozes from the chamber, tears fell from the eyes with lost souls trapped inside, hand on the trigger, hands up, don't shoot, liberty, it's just me.
Oh, that was cold. That was cold. And you said picnic. And we all, well, I can't say we all, but we know the stories behind picnic or pick a nick.
Yeah.
We have to get you back. We have to get you back on our skeptic show and have some real conversation.
Oh, yeah. I get real.
Wow. That was cold.
Thank you.
Dope. Man, you're something else.
Appreciate it. Y'all wasn't expecting that, huh?
No, not at all. Man, that was super deep.
Yeah, I got more of that.
Wow.
Yeah.
So are you working on putting that kind of stuff out?
Yeah, you know, actually I wanna put a book out, you know. So actually I have a couple ideas. It's just, you know, trying to figure out where to start. But, you know, because, like I said, the way social media is, actually, it's kind of crazy. Nick Cannon, he kind of started doing what I kind of wanted to do, like just doing the video and posting it. So, low-key, I might just do it, court. Everybody's going to be like, oh, she copied. But it is what it is, you know. I think I might end up just doing that and, like, you know, probably still release a book, because I got a couple. I have, you know, some about black women. I got one about fallen angels. Like, my poetry is just like my lyrics. It is real deep. It makes you definitely think. Like, I remember I wrote a song called Judgment Day. Just imagine what that's like, you know. I had one that talks about Egypt, you know, and everything that's going on. So it needs to definitely be said, and since people are listening, you know, that's one thing I learned. Everybody, like a million people might not be listening, but out of a million people, there's 500 that's listening. There's 200 that's listening. Mm-hmm. And them 200 that's listening is going to have other people listening.
That's right.
And, you know, nothing dies in social media or internet. So it's always going to be there. So when it becomes cool again, people will start listening.
Definitely. Yeah, again, that was cold. Guys, we are out of time tonight. Oh, man. But I want to thank you guys, my Vigilantes family, as always, for checking out the podcast over here at Vigilantes Radio. All episodes are available for free download, and you can grab that from Spreaker.com/Only One Media Group. Be sure to follow us there. Or you can grab it from iTunes, YouTube, or over at our website, which again is OnlyOneMediaGroup.com. And that goes for every single episode that we've ever aired. If you'd like to request music or a guest or send something for us to play, email it to me at vradio@onlyonemediagroup.com. Here's my disclaimer. We are genre-free. We do not judge, and we absolutely do not base our opinions on hearsay, but facts alone. And actually scratch all of that, because all of my opinions are always right. It's the bottom line. This is my show. It's just something you got to deal with. Nah, just kidding. On behalf of myself, Dini Mussolini, I appreciate all you guys for tuning in either afterwards or live with us. Spread the word, because sharing is caring. Also, special thanks to our guest, Angelique Bates, for joining us tonight. We stepped our game up just for you guys to make sure that you have the best experience here on our show. You never know. Dini may just end up on a song with Alizé. Who knows? Okay, my friends. Just remember, well, me, Alizé, and Busy. How about that?
Right.
Right. All right. Well, just remember to be yourself and be absolutely freaking great at just doing that. Peace and have a wonderful night.
Bye.
You are now listening to Vigilantes Radio, the people's choice for quality interviews, art, music, and hot topics. Hosted by Demetrius Houdini Black Reynolds of the duo No Longer the Hero. Co-hosted by the Vigilantes Banditti. Call in to join the mix. All episodes of this podcast are available for free download at www.onlyonemediagroup.com.